So we're going to pick up on the theme that God has been taking us through. For those that don't know, a group of us went away last weekend, before this weekend, to a ladies' conference. And it was a power-packed, emotional weekend in the presence of a holy God who is cutting across the body of Christ in a truth to call us back. He's calling his church back to himself and is asking us to resurrender our hearts in purity before him. So just to lay a little bit of foundation before I go on to the next stage that God has taken me on to as I've been considering what it means, we were talking about consecration, talking about which consecration means the action of making or declaring something sacred. We are called to bring our lives as a sacrifice unto the Lord, that we become sacred in him. What does sacred mean? Sacred means that we are connected with and dedicated to God. And there's a dedication of our hearts that God calls us into that takes us onto a whole new dimension of intimacy with him. And no matter how long we have been on our journey, there are moments in life where God will cut across our heart by the power of the Spirit and say, enough is enough. You've come so far that there is more. How dedicated are we to following him? How determined are we that it is all about him, not about us? So dedicated means that we are devoted to a task or a purpose. So consecration is becoming sacred, which means connected with and dedicated to God. And in that dedication, we are devoted to the task or the purpose in front of us. We are devoted to the Lord Jesus Christ and the purpose and the truth and the power of the cross and everything that God is asking of our lives to be for him. And building on that this week, the Lord got my attention on one word, the word pure. And it's not something I would probably normally have considered doing a Bible study on. But when God gets your attention, I know it's not just for me, he's building on this consecration, this dedication, this devotion that we are to have with him. But what is the attitude of our heart in it? Being aware that in everything that we are before him, any transformation change that's going to take place in us is only going to happen because of the Holy Spirit, as Jackie said, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord, that when we come in humility and surrender, dedicated to him, to cross over the line that's in front of us, where he invites us onto a whole new depth of journey with him, we actually say yes to him to allow the Holy Spirit to take us there. Because every single one of us knows in the frailty of who we are in the flesh, we get in the way. And we put such limitation on ourselves as we make it all about us and not about him. When God simply says, come to me in a surrender, consecrate yourself to me, dedicate yourself, be determined in me, but then lay yourself before me to allow my spirit to lead you. Because believe me, for every step that we desire to take into his presence and purposes, we cannot do it in our own strength. And we go off in human logic of what we think it looks like instead of surrendering to God to know what he desires it to be. And it's step by step. And often we look at people who are, if you, for want of a better phraseology, are probably ahead of us in the journey. And we get so captivated by how they are demonstrating Jesus, we believe we've got to be like them. No, we need to be like him. My journey is different to yours. Your journey is different to mine. But every single one of us called by Jesus is staying on that narrow road of our journey for God that he calls us into individually, means that we become everything that he desires us all to be separately for him. So we're not clones. We're not all one type of person. He's given us different appearances, different characters, and is given, is writing a different story over each one of our lives for purpose in him. Yes, we're learning many different principles, and some of us get there just like that. We hear a truth, we grasp it, and we say, yes, Lord, I surrender. And there's others who will hear that same truth and think, really not sure about that, Lord. I can't do that, Lord. I'm not sure I even want to do that, Lord. I mean, how dare we say that to a holy God? But how many times do we? Because we get so captivated in our own understanding and our own will and our own wants. Because we go by what we want and God goes by what we need. And until we can surrender to the want, to the need, we actually block ourselves from being able to go forward because we're the ones in total control. And until we come to that surrender before a holy God to say, yes, Lord, have your way with me, whatever the cost, then God cannot bring it into our lives. So when we look at the word pure, pure means not mixed or adulterated with any other substance or material. That was the definition in the dictionary. So then I had to look at the word adulterated. I'm being honest, step by step, learning together. We need to look deeper. So pure means not mixed or adulterated with any other substance or material. Adulterated means render something poorer in quality by adding another substance. In other words, the purity is something is pure when it is not mixed, when it's not diluted with anything else. It's not contaminated by other materials, right? So if we do add something to it, then we make it poorer in quality by adding something to it. We cannot add anything to the Lord Jesus Christ and the power of the cross. He is who he is, the Son of God. He died on that cross, crucified to set us free. He has done it all. There's nothing we can add to what Jesus has done or who he is to make Jesus any better than he is. He is pure in truth, in love and sacrifice, in surrender. We are called in him to live a life of power and glory for him. Not because of who we are, but because of who he is. So when we water it down by adding ourselves into the mix, yes, Jesus, I see that you're there. You died on the cross, your love, grace, your mercy. You took the fall for me. You went to hell that I don't have to. But then we bring ourselves. But if I just do this, it will make me more worthy. If I try to help Jesus out, by being so determined and being in control of what I know that I should be, but it's not in a surrender and letting go to allow God in the Holy Spirit to make that change in us. It comes from the outward in to contaminate instead of the Holy Spirit in us to separate us from the ways of the world to bring us into purity before Christ. And often we get in God's way. Because we bring ourselves into the mix and then we start telling God how we're going to do it. We start showing God a better way to do it in our own understanding. And we don't surrender in all the completeness of what surrender means. We go step by step on what we think we're able to let go of. Because we all hold on to the comfort zone and familiarity of what we know. Until we get the breakthrough that Jesus shows us there is a better way. And suddenly in the spirit, we cross over that line to say, okay, Lord, I'm willing to fully surrender. I'm going to free fall with you. It's like standing at the top of a mountain and you're standing with your feet right on the edge. And many of us stand on the edge of that mountain and we lift one foot in the air. And we say, yes, Lord, I am willing to step off this difficulty, this mountain. I am willing to trust you. But we hover balanced on one foot. We've lifted one foot up to half let go, and we're balancing. But the truth of true surrender is when we say to God, I am yours, and we literally allow both feet to leave the mountain, and we free fall with him in the spirit, knowing he will catch us. We will not be destroyed. We will not die. But that total surrender means that we free fall in the spirit to enjoy the journey with God, no matter how painful and difficult it can get at times, as we realize the mess of who we are. Because believe me, when we start truly surrendering and free falling, The enemy comes with all the guilt, condemnation, and shame to show us the mess up of who we are. And God has to reveal something of the frailty of who we are to challenge us. Are we willing to give it up? And it's as we're willing to give it up that he takes hold of us and lovingly catches us and takes us on the journey into the more than. But we love to be in control, don't we? We love to hold on to the familiar. We don't like taking risks. And yet if we don't take a risk, we're never going to have the more of what God wants to provide for us. We're never going to step into the true identity of who we are in him. Because unless we're prepared to take a risk and come out of the comfort zone to step into, we're never going to see the glimpse of what God is showing us. So we have got to be prepared to do something different, to have something different. And when we look at pure in Psalm 12, verse 6, we're talking about the Bible, the word of God. And it says, and the words of the Lord are flawless. If something is flawless, it means it is absolutely perfect. It says, and the words of the Lord are flawless, like silver purified in the crucible, like gold refined seven times. If you've ever seen the silversmith working, there is a heat that comes under the metal and it heats up and it becomes liquid. And the silversmith watches it. And as it's bubbling at this high temperature, he's watching it intently because as it is heated up, anything of impurity in that silver floats to the surface. And the silversmith has to skim it off. And as he watches, there comes a point where he knows that that silver is absolutely pure, that there is no dross in it, there is no contamination in it. It's not been watered by anything. How does he know? Because when the silversmith is watching that silver molten pot, when it is absolutely pure and shiny silver, the silversmith can see his reflection in it. And that's when he knows it's absolutely pure and ready for purpose. And that's when we know we are becoming pure in God, because we will have a reflection of Jesus in ourselves, that we will see ourselves in him. There's a purification in him that causes the radiance of Christ to radiate in us, through us, and beyond us. So the word of God is like silver purified in a crucible. It is pure. You can't add anything to it. You can't take anything away. You cannot change it. The word says right at the end of the Bible, anybody who does this will suffer consequences. We cannot change the word of God to make it mean what we want it to mean. It is pure, solid, and truth every single time, like gold refined seven times. How many times does gold have to go through the refining process to become a deeper quality, whether it's 9-carat gold, 18-carat gold, 24-carat gold, and whatever beyond? The more it is refined by the fire, the more pure it actually becomes. And that's what the word of God does for us. It refines us through the fire of the word of God. But the word of God is pure. We have to read it, take it to heart, believe it, stand on it, and know the meaning of it as God is speaking to us today in the relevance of it. Psalm 19, verse 8. Psalm 19, verse 8 says, the precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. So again, I went to the dictionary. What does the word precept mean? The word precept means a general rule intended to regulate behavior or thought. So the rule of God means that it brings a teaching and an understanding that regulates what we think and how we behave. And it says the precepts of the Lord are right. God is always right. I often say there's no point in me arguing with God because he is always right. He has the perfect answer. I can't go to God and tell him what I want him to do. I have to go to God in a surrender that I'm willing to obey. So the ways of God are right, giving joy to the heart. And I'm sure there's one or two in the room that might even smirk at that one and think, yeah, really? Because I find it really difficult sometimes to follow what God is asking, because it is alien to the natural flesh environment and the worldly ways in which we live. But when God cuts across in his truth to say there's a different way, there's a better way, stop doing that, stop being like that, and be who I lead you to be. There's many a times we put the block on when we say, I cannot do that. Now that is true, you can't, because it's only the Holy Spirit in you and through you that can do it for you. But we have to surrender to be willing to allow him to do it. So the precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. When God commands something in authority and truth of who he is, and we grasp it, there is an incredible freedom. And we know when we get the freedom, we're transformed and changed. But other people will look at us and say, you've changed. There's a radiance and a freedom that comes out of our living standard, our lifestyle, that people can't help and look and say, what has happened to you? I know if anybody met me now to see and hear what I now do, that knew me 20 years ago when I was the shy, stammering wallflower of a woman who used to hide away and just hidden beyond the crowd, they would look at me today and say, my goodness, what has happened to you? For the radiance of Jesus, of the power of the Holy Spirit in my life, as I have chosen to surrender and let go and let God have his way. And I'm not perfect and neither are you. We're all on a journey and we're at this stage now, but God wants to do more. So his precepts give joy. His commands are radiant. What he instructs us into brings an incredible light into the darkness, and the radiance of Christ bubbles up in us and through us for purpose. And it gives light to the eyes. It shows us the direction that we should go in. And when someone is at peace with Jesus, there is a twinkle in our eyes. There is a joy in our heart, and we can't help but just smile at the world. It lights up the path before us. Psalm 24, in verse 3, which I haven't got written here, it says, Who can ascend the holy hill? Okay. Rachel, can you read it, please, from verse 3?
Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord?
Yeah.
Who may stand in his holy place?
Yeah. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in that holy place? And then it goes on in verse 4 and 5, it says, the one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. The one who has clean hands and a pure heart. We talk about approaching God. We know in the frailty of our flesh that we're not perfect, and we don't qualify to be able to, except by the invitation of God, who says, come to me and allow me to do in you what I desire to do. But we have to consider the attitude of the actions of our hands and the attitude of our heart. Because if we are knowingly rebelling against the truth of God, we cannot approach the Holy God. There is a Holy Spirit conviction that has to come, that we come into true repentance, to lay down the frailty of who we are, that in repentance we approach the throne of God. We cannot expect to go to the throne of God in all the mess and in pride to say, how I am does not matter. There is a repentance in Holy Spirit conviction that God will bring us to, that takes us into that place where in repentance our hands are washed in the blood of Christ from anything that we have done wrong. And the heart is cleansed from any wrong attitude. And we cannot trust in other idols. We cannot put anything or anybody above God. When we come to God to say, I give my all to you, Lord, we can't say, but you can only touch that part of my life, or you can only have that part of my life, but please don't touch this. Please don't change this. Because whatever this is that we're holding on to, that we dare to say to a holy God, you cannot touch it, that is the idol in our life. And any idol we have here, we are putting above God there. And we can come and deceive ourselves and say, I'm surrendered, everything I have is yours, Lord. But in any consideration, but don't touch that. We're putting that above God as an idol. And we cannot have idols in our life. And we cannot swear by false gods. We stand on the power of the cross, the name of Jesus Christ. He is our all, and we stand in him. There is no other power greater than him, and nothing else that we should turn to instead of him. And it says in verse 5, they will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. So the one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in idols or swear by false gods, they will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. So when our heart is in the right place and purified before a holy God, that we are taken full ownership of all the choices that we've made, we've come into true repentance and accountability for everything that we've done, that we are taking ownership and responsibility of our lives before a holy God to keep our hearts pure in him, then we will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God our Savior. When we are being wrongly accused, but our heart is in the right place before God, the battle belongs to the Lord. He will vindicate us. We do not have to prove anything nor defend ourselves to anybody. In Psalm 51, verse 10, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. That should be the heart's cry every single day, Lord. I know I'm impure. I know that I'm human, and I know that the flesh gets in the way, and I'm being contaminated by the ways of the world. But Lord, today, I come to you today, creating me a pure heart. Show me the truth, Lord, of where I'm at. Show me, Lord, what would block my way forward with you. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. The steadfast is that determination we talked about at the beginning. Renew that determination. Give me a spirit of determination towards you, God. Change me that I get disciplined and determined in you and back on that narrow road with you. Psalm 119, verse 9 says, how can a young person stay on the path of purity? You know, the young people, we've got age and some wisdom that enables us to say to the youngsters of today, I've been there, done that, got the t-shirt, and believe me, you don't want to do it. Do they want to listen to us? No. Because they think we're just the killjoy to the journey that they want to take. We sometimes, with our children, we have to let them go and make their choices, and they fall into the pit before they're raised up into the purity. We've been down that journey ourselves. In fact, we are still on it. There are many times we still fall into the pit before we get to the purity and the power. But how does a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. When children are raised as Bible-believing followers, there is a foundation in their spirit that if they choose to follow it, there's a determination in them that they can stand in truth to live a holy life. Staying on that path of purity, that they dare to be different to their peers, different to the ways of the world, because God is showing them that different way. Proverbs 15:26 says, the Lord detests the thoughts of the wicked, but gracious words are pure in his sight. Of course, the Lord has to come against the negativity of the world's way. How we think differently to what he would have us be. We are in a dual nature, the flesh nature of the world and the Holy Spirit nature of Jesus, that because we confess his name and choose to follow him, there is a war going on, the two natures battling with each other. And of course, God cannot look at the negativity of the world's way in our thinking and bless it. So it says, the Lord detests the thought of the wicked. There are people who do not know Jesus whose thoughts are nothing but pure evil. We can see it going on around us, and God detests it. But it says, but gracious words are pure in his sight. When we are so gracious in him, when we know him and demonstrate him, then the graciousness of how we will be speaking becomes pure in his sight. Proverbs 16, verse 2 says, all a person's ways seem pure to them, but motives are weighed by the Lord. Do you know, there are many people that can be seen to want to do the right thing. But God knows the motive and the attitude of the heart as to why they are doing it. So God doesn't look at the task and the action of what people are doing. God considers the attitude of the heart behind it. So yes, I can stand up in public and do something that everybody's watching me do. But am I doing it to say, hey guys, look at me, aren't I good? Or am I doing it in humility that that person's need is beyond what I want for myself? And I humbly sacrifice what I want to go and be what that person needs me to be to them, to serve them at that moment in time. And I do it in humility, not pride. God knows the motives of the heart and he weighs it against what we are doing. And when we are doing anything in pride, to be noticed and seen for ourselves, it's like filthy rags to the Lord. So it doesn't matter how good somebody looks in what they're doing time and time again. If they're doing it with the wrong heart motive, there is no reward. And many people are performing. Many people are doing what they want because it looks good for them as they stand out in pride to want to bring attention. They are self-seeking, not God-serving people. Proverbs 20, verse 11 says, even small children are known by their actions. So is their conduct really pure and upright? You know, we had a classic in the Sunday school yesterday that no matter how much I was trying to teach this particular lesson to the children, there was one child who was cutting across what I was saying the whole time. And he was basically trying to be clever. And he was determined that he was going to have his way. The problem is, the subject matter of what I was talking about was about how God came down on the Tower of Babel and separated the people and gave them all different languages to destroy what man would be able to do for themselves, that they would not need him. And bless him, this young boy, he behaved in such a way that how I had to parallel the story at that time was to confront him in love, to ask him as how did his behavior line up with the story that I was telling. But eventually he came to an understanding that actually he was being the troublemaker. God is so gracious on how he leads, but even small children are known by their actions. Young children in their frailty, I know what this young boy's issue is. He was literally seeking attention, but he was doing it in completely the wrong way. But I praise God, God turned it around for a blessing all round for us all, that he received what he needed, but not to disrupt everybody else from what they actually needed too. So small children are known by their actions. It starts at a very young age. So is their conduct really pure and upright? Matthew 5, verse 8 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. When our hearts are not contaminated by the wrong thinking and ways of the world, by pride and the selfishness of who we are, if we are coming to God in the purity of our heart, that it's all about him and not about us, we will see God. But there's a purification that needs to come into our hearts to allow us to really do that. Every time we cut across God, that there's more of ourselves coming to him instead of the surrender of ourselves to him, we will block what God desires to do. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. 2 Corinthians 7 verse 1 says, therefore, since we have these promises, dear friends, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. The Holy Bible is full of thousands of promises from God. We have those promises But to receive them, there is a purification in our own hearts, in our own spirit, that needs to take place in order to be able to live out those promises in all the fullness of God. Therefore, it's our responsibility as we search ourselves before God to allow the Holy Spirit to purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit. What are we thinking? What are we doing physically with our bodies? Are our thoughts and our actions lining up with the purity and truth of how Jesus would have our lives lived for him? And when the Holy Spirit conviction comes, we have a free will choice. Will we listen to God's voice and allow him to transform and change us, that we repent of the error of our thoughts, we repent of the error of our ways, and we purify our actions in him to say, Lord, I know this is wrong and I'm willing to give it up. You know, whatever we vow before the Lord, God expects us to follow through on what we vow. When we say we will give something up, God will hold us to that vow. And he expects us to turn away from the wrong way and live in the correct way before him. So be careful what we say before God, because whatever we confess to God that we're willing to sacrifice and give up for him, he will hold us to it. He expects us to turn away from what we know to be wrong. He will help us by the power of his spirit in us, but we have to be fully willing and not be flippant with our words that we say something to God that we're not willing to do, because he will hold us accountable one day. So we need to purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit. Who are the toxic people in your life who are holding you back? Who are the naysayers in your life that are bringing limitation and restriction and saying you can't do that? You so want to say yes to God and go and be and do. And then somebody says, no, that isn't who you are. Come and sit here with me in the position that I know that you have and the person I know you to be. You don't have to do what God is saying. You don't have to give that up. You don't have to let go of that relationship. You don't have to go to that place. Stay here with me. I know who you are, is what people say to us. I know who you are. Come and stay where I know you are supposed to be. And we need to be aware of the relationships around us that want to hold us back where we have been when God has called us out of that place to go into a new place with him to be who he's called us to be. So there is a contamination that comes relationally. There's a contamination comes by the things we put into our body that we shouldn't, the behavior of our bodies that we shouldn't be performing in. We have to be prepared to give up that contamination to our body and our spirit, that we are perfecting holiness out of reverence for God, that he is our all, our everything, and the very reason why we live, the existence and the purpose for which we are called, that it's all about him. That everything we are, everything we speak, everything we do, everything we radiate is Jesus Christ personified, that we are the radiance of Christ into this painful world. And if we're not purified in him to be able to do that, we will walk in the contamination of the world and blend in with the world, and Jesus will be lost in the world. So we have to be prepared to separate from the world and stand out for the world, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. Because we have a reverent fear of a holy God, that whatever we do that is worldly, we will be judged for one day. But we can only have that crossover in the spirit by the surrender of our hearts in humility before a holy God to allow the Holy Spirit to do it. It's not by our might. It's not by our willpower. It's because we allow the Holy Spirit to do what only God is able to do. In 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2 and 3. Says, I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy. I promise you to one husband, to Christ, so that I might present you as a pure virgin to him. But I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. God is a jealous God. God is a jealous God. We are the bride of Christ. We are to be presented before him as pure. But we are in a battle. And just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning in the Garden of Eden, so our minds get led astray that we may say with our mouth that we sincerely want to be devoted to follow Jesus and become all that he desires our life to be for him. And yet the enemy comes and deceives us with what we are thinking, that we say it with our lips, we don't mean it with our hearts. And if we have confessed before God, that's what I desire, but don't speak it from the confession of our hearts, we're giving it lip service, not heart surrender. And our words have power. God will hold us to what we confess. So the enemy comes to deceive us, to say, you know, how many times do you have altar calls in church? How many people go forward because their best friend went forward? Not because the Holy Spirit's challenged them and convicted them and they say yes in desperation to a holy God. Yes, Lord, this is who I desire to be for you. I give my life for you. It's, oh, everybody else has got up and gone. I'd better go too. And we've already said God examines the attitude of the heart by everything that we do. If it's not a sincere dedication and determination of ourselves before a holy God, it's worthless. The enemy deceives us. And we've been forward. People have seen us go forward. We're deceiving everybody else that witnesses us go forward. But most of all, we're deceiving ourselves. But we cannot deceive God, because he tests the attitude of our heart behind everything that we are doing. We have got to be sincere. It's me and him. I have nothing to prove and nothing to defend to you. But I am one day going to be judged by a holy God when I stand before him for what I did. And if it was out of pretense and performance and pride, I will be judged for that. So the attitude of the heart matters. He is a jealous God. He wants us for himself. Philippians 1, verse 9 and 10 says, and this is my prayer, so that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. That your love may abound at more and more in knowledge and depth of insight. Our love for the Lord Jesus Christ says that we put our hearts in place to learn more of who he is, to be in the depth of the Bible, to be spending daily devotional time with him, to want to go deeper with him, in understanding with him. But that depth of knowledge and insight is out of our love for him. How do we show our love for him? Jesus said, if you obey my commands, you show that you love me. How do we know what those commands are if we don't read the word of God and be led by the Holy Spirit into obedience, into where God is leading us, no matter what the cost? That is how we show love to him. But there is, our love for Jesus has got to so flow in desperation and determination that we are reading the word of God. We're going deeper in our knowledge and insight of who he is, so that we can discern and make wise choices in him, that we stay pure and blameless in everything that we think, everything that we are, and everything that we do, everything that we speak. There's a purity that we are blameless, that if Jesus comes back tonight, the way we have lived our lives is so pure in him, he doesn't have to judge us for what we did wrong. And that's why we need to keep short account with God. That's why we need to allow the Holy Spirit to convict us. And I know many people say, oh, well, when I get to the end of the day, I pray and I repent of anything during the day that I may have said or done wrong or not said or done. What if Jesus came back at 3 o'clock in the afternoon? What if Jesus comes back at 11 o'clock in the morning? You haven't got to your bedtime to lie there in the whole consideration of what have I said or done wrong today? Oh, Lord, forgive me. We need to be living in short account with God that the Holy Spirit is so fired up in us, in our conscience, that the minute I think something that is a wrong thought, I can immediately say, sorry, Lord, that was so not of you. Forgive me. But when I speak something that shouldn't have come out of my mouth, I'm so, so sorry, Lord. I am so, so sorry, God, for what I've just done. Please forgive me. But actually speaking to the person I've just said it to and said, I'm so sorry for what I've just done wrong. Will you please forgive me too? But everything about our daily living, our conscience is so fine-tuned and refined in him that we immediately take ownership. This is wrong. I repent. And we keep a short account with God. Because if in the next 2 minutes Jesus comes back, we are going to be judged and be accountable. How refined in the spirit are we that we would stay so close to Jesus not to want to be out of his will? So we need to be able to discern what is best, that we remain pure and blameless for Jesus coming back. In Philippians 4, verse 8, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. There needs to be a shift in our hearts. There needs to be a shift in our spirit. There is so much good going on. But humanly, we always get drawn to what isn't good. We all notice the negative before we notice the positive. And we need to start living in an attitude of gratitude. We sang earlier about having gratitude before a holy God. We need to start living in that in every breath that we take. Being thankful for what is instead of keep complaining and grumbling for what isn't. Standing before a holy God in such a love for him that what is going on that isn't good doesn't contaminate us. That it doesn't burn into our spirit to shift us and take us down and under circumstance, because we're so thankful here for what is rather than complaining about the things that aren't. In the final verse, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings. Just going to read that again. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings. F-A-I-T-H. Full assurance in the heart. That by faith, we have full assurance in our heart that God is who he says that he is, that we are sincere in our heart relationship with him, that we are surrendered, determined, and sacrificed unto him, that we are fully consecrated, that we are disciplined and focused, that God can move by the power of his spirit to draw us ever closer to him. The word says, we draw close to God, he will draw close to us. It comes because God cannot cut across our free will choice and make us be who he wants us to be. He cannot make us read the word. He cannot make us continue in prayer. He cannot make us do what he wants us to do. It's all about the free will choice. Therefore, it's that we draw close to him in our surrender and sacrifice and desire for him. He draws close to us to enable and equip and empower us to be the way that his son is. There's a crossover in the spirit. So let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, and God knows the truth of our hearts. We cannot deceive him. With the full assurance that faith brings, the full assurance in the heart, that by faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. In other words, when we draw so close to God to know the truth of the word and his ways, when we are sincere in the surrender and sacrifice of our heart and lives for him, that we are fully assured that by faith, God is more than able to do what we desire him to do in us and through us, then we have our hearts sprinkled in him to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. Because the more refined we are in him, the more we're going to radiate Christ. Just like the silver, heated up, purified, becomes shiny, radiates Christ. That's what happens in our lives when we get cleaned up by Jesus and having our bodies washed with pure water. that everything we think, everything we are, everything we do is Christ-like. So God is calling us to be consecrated, to be dedicated to him. But he's calling for a purity in the spirit, in our hearts, that as we draw close to him, he will bring about the transformation change in us. And we all know when we've got it. We all know when we get there. We all know when we overcome. Because the release of the burden of our hearts and our spirit is lifted. We get the breakthrough moment and nothing can hold us down. We are set free in Jesus' name. The truth of the word sets us free. In Jesus, we are free indeed. That is a purity that God is calling us into, a challenge out of this being consecrated to Jesus and what it really means. And God is calling the body of Christ to himself. And those who are true believers and followers of the Lord Jesus Christ will step out of the world and into the more of him. And then we are his willing, obedient servants through whom he can bring himself to touch the lives of others. We are all called. But where is our dedication, determination, and consecration and purity before our holy God? In Jesus' name, amen.